Let's chat. Radio Disney talks to special guests from around the bay with something to say. Let's find out who we've got today on Let's Chat.
All right. So today we have got three very special guests joining me in the studio today. Today I am chatting with Colleen Yu, the president for the California State PTA, Maggie Steele, the vice president for family engagement at the California State PTA, and Superintendent Richard Carranza, who is the superintendent for the San Francisco Unified School District. Welcome, everyone.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Well, I am so excited to have you guys all here today. And, you know, school has already gone back into session. I know, especially out here in San Francisco, the kids are already back in school. Some other students are starting next week and the upcoming weeks. And today's show is all about going back to school and what our parents need to know. And so I'm so excited to have all three of you here today because you're representing all different areas. And I think you guys are going to give some great tips on what we can do to make sure that our parents are ready for their kids to go back to school and make sure the kids are ready to go back to school as well. So before we start talking about what we can do to get our parents informed for the back to school season, I'd love for each of you to introduce yourselves and tell us a little bit about what it is that you do. So Colleen, why don't we go ahead and start with you?
Good morning. My name's Colleen Yu, and I'm president of the California State PTA. The way I got involved in PTA is quite simple. I got involved when my children were in elementary school. At that time, I really had no idea what PTA was about, and I was asked to join by a fellow parent. And gradually, I came to learn that PTA advocates for every child with one voice. Our sole concern is the health, education, and welfare of all children. That made me very excited. So gradually, I took on more leadership positions in PTA until I find myself today as a state PTA president.
And you've got a huge job. I mean, it's not just the PTA, it's the state PTA, which covers all of California, correct?
Correct. We have over 3,600 PTA schools in the state of California. And as a state association, we are really focused on supporting those school PTAs with their leadership skills, with information, and with resources.
It's a big job you've got there, Colleen. Now, Maggie, if you could tell us a little bit about yourself and what it is that you do.
Well, I'm very happy to be here today, and I'm the Vice President for Family Engagement for California State PTA. I first got involved probably about 15 years ago when my own kids were in elementary school, and my first PTA activity was to run a carnival booth for our elementary school, and that was a lot of fun, and certainly I was hooked thereafter.
Clearly, 15 years later, you're still part of the PTA. I love it. Awesome. And Superintendent Carranza, can you tell us a little bit about yourself and what it is that you do?
Sure. Well, I serve as a superintendent of schools for San Francisco Unified School District. But, you know, I think my biggest claim to fame, if you will, is that I'm a parent of two public school students in San Francisco, and I'm a member of the 2nd District PTA here in San Francisco. And I think that is so important for folks to understand that PTA encompasses everyone. Everyone can be a part of PTA.
Absolutely. And I'll have you know, and my listeners know, I'm a student of the San Francisco Unified School District, a former student, and my mom was big in the PTA when I was in school, so it's something that I know very well and hold dear to my heart, and so I am so excited to have all of you guys here today. So thank you all for introducing yourselves. Now, as I mentioned earlier, kids are already back in school, they're getting back into school in these next upcoming weeks, and we want to make sure the parents are ready for them to go back to school, and apparently, which I did not realize, there's a lot that parents need to know. So before we kind of talk about that, can you tell us about the PTA? You know, Colleen and Maggie, you know, you both obviously work for the California State PTA, but I'd love for you to tell our listeners, our parents and our students out there more about the PTA and what the PTA Association does. I mean, all I know about the PTA is that it stands for Parent Teacher Association, and I'm sure that's as far as a lot of parents know as well. So if you could tell us a little bit more about what the PTA is and what it does.
Sure. First of all, just to clarify, we're not employees of the PTA, we're volunteers. And all of our over 850,000 members in the state of California don't work for PTA, they are either members or volunteers.
Good to know.
The primary focus for PTA is really to connect families and schools. We are part of the fabric of schools and communities across the state. As I mentioned, we have over 3,600 school PTAs throughout the state, and our dedicated volunteers really invest a lot of time to inform parents and engage them and the education leaders in the decision making at schools. We really want to strengthen that overall connection between families and schools. So at our school PTAs, PTAs provide a lot of enrichment programs, all with the goal to positively impact the lives of children and families.
Now, as the president for the California State PTA, what exactly is the state PTA versus a local PTA?
The state PTA is made up of representatives from all of our 29 districts. We're governed by a board of directors. We do have a small staff in Sacramento, but primarily our larger board of managers is made up of representatives from across the state of California, and they serve on different commissions that deal with health, education, family engagement. We also have some membership commission. So all of those volunteers, including consultants and advisory board members, work to support the work that's going on locally at our school PTAs.
Gotcha. Okay. Now, I know the PTA are big advocates for STEM and the arts and all of that as well, right? I know we've actually done a show on that previously this year. Can you talk a little bit about that?
Absolutely. PTA has a very focused attention to science, technology, engineering, and math, as well as the arts. We know that as part of a well-rounded education, children need to be exposed to the arts. We are looking to support parents so that their child's education will allow them to be competitive in our global workforce. So PTA is very interested in helping support parents by providing information about STEM, and also our school PTAs really actively promote the arts in education. We have a reflections program, which allows students to participate at the school level in visual and performing arts and music. So PTA has a long history of focus on the arts.
Very, very cool. Now, with back to school season, when I was a student, I loved the back to school season, which is so funny because you would think the kids are more excited about summer. But when I was a student, I loved the back to school season because I used to get to go shopping and pick out my new outfit and all of that. That was the fun part for me. But I know for a lot of kids out there, it can cause some anxiety and, you know, they get a little nervous, and parents as well. You know, I mean, it's a big time and parents need to prep for it and the kids need to plan as well. So what can parents do to help their kids during this time of year?
I think you're right. Back to school season is really can be very hectic for families. So getting the year off to a good start is always important, I think. And it can influence a child all the way through the school year in terms of their attitudes and their confidence and maybe even their performance, both socially and academically. You can help your child to start the year right and get into the swing of things by really doing a little preparation in advance so they have a positive school experience. Regardless of their age, you can talk to your child about the upcoming year. You can reassure them. You can let them know that everyone shares, you know, little worries and anxieties about getting back to school. But you can also encourage them about the positives. Going back to school means seeing your friends again that you might not have seen all summer, and also meeting new people and doing new things and having new learning experiences. So it is an exciting time for families.
That's right. You know, that was always the best part. During the summertime, I never got to see a lot of my friends. And you're right. When school starts again, they're all back there with me. So that was really cool. And I heard there was something about calming start of school jitters. Is that something you can talk about?
Yes. I think it's important for parents to realize that, you know, no matter how much fun school is, it's a big deal for students. So calming back to school jitters is as simple as just ramping up to the start of the school year with students, making sure that their backpacks are in order. If there's new school clothes, that's great. But starting to get on a routine for getting up a little earlier, starting to clear the space where they'll have to do their homework, looking at lists that schools may have sent in advance around materials and supplies, maybe even walking the route to school or driving the route to school, just really ramping up the experiences that students will be engaged in when they go to school. And for parents, just being very, very cognizant of what questions they want to ask, whether it has to do with, you know, free and reduced lunch meal applications, or where's the pickup and drop off? How do I get involved with our PTA? What's my opportunity to get involved in many different ways? All of that will calm jitters because you're ramping up to that experience on the first day back.
I love that suggestion, especially the routine with kids waking up early. I'm going to tell you a funny story really quickly. My little cousin started school, and all summer he's been, you know, they let the kids stay up late, and so he'd been sleeping in late, and first day back to school, what did he do? Woke up late. So but he wasn't late for school. He had to rush really quickly. So I love that you said routines, work on that, especially ahead of time, because that is definitely important. So let's talk a little bit about family engagement in education and why it's so important for parents and families to be involved, and what can parents do to actually get involved.
Well, I think the primary thing that a parent can do at a school is, first of all, join the PTA. And that doesn't necessarily mean that a parent has to volunteer, but it does show that the parent really cares about the children and values education. And we know that all parents value education. They want what's best for their children. And parents are children's first teachers. And so by modeling this behavior of engagement, children then grow to value education too. And this engagement is not dependent on family income or social status. It's the same for all families, and children really pick up on this. And we see it in terms of children having higher grades when their parents are engaged. They have better attendance at school.
Wow.
They have a positive attitude toward learning. And they really understand the link between what they're learning at school and future careers.
Well, and I think, you know, it's important because when the parents are involved, it shows their child that they really care about what they're doing in school and that they want to know more. And I think that is great. When I was in school, my mom was very involved. As I said, she was part of the PTA at my school. And I may not have necessarily liked mom being at school with me, but I loved that mom knew what I was actually doing. You know, she was great. And that really wasn't important. You know, that my mom knew exactly what I was learning in school, the books that I was reading, you know, it actually was pretty cool.
Well, I think as well, exactly as Colleen's suggesting, that when parents take a role and an active role in their children's education, they do help that child succeed in school. They also signal that learning's important in their house for the child and for the future. And certainly too, it's really a simple equation. Family engagement does lead to higher grades and more academic success and social success for children. When families are involved and are interested in what's happening in a regular school day, that encourages a child to understand that learning's important. So I always think it's important to try to take some time in the day to talk to your child about how was their school day and ask them simple questions. You know, what were three things that happened today that you enjoyed? That sort of thing. And that way you get a conversation going and you're also signaling to them that their school life is very important to your family.
Exactly. And you know, the questions that you ask are actually very important as well. As you know, you said, ask your child, what are three things that you learned in school today? Which is a great question, as opposed to when your child gets home, it's not like, oh, did you have fun with your friend Bobby at school today? You know, it's more of a question that gets them talking about school and it, you know, reinforces what they've learned. They can tell you, oh, mom, I learned 2 + 2 = 4 today in school. Or I learned, you know, science is all around us and science is part of math and all that. So I absolutely agree that questions are great to ask, but it really is important what the question is that you ask your kids as well.
Sure. I think it also becomes more important as students get older in school. If you ask the question, how was school today? It was fine, you know, and that's about the extent of it.
Right.
But those probing questions. Tell me what you did today. What was your favorite class today? Who did you meet that was new today?
Right.
You know, those types of probing questions are really important. Part of what I really appreciate about PTA and PTA's presence in our schools, I can tell you that there are school communities in San Francisco that have not had PTA, organized PTAs in the past, and then have had organized PTAs. And what it's really served to do is to be a catalyst for parent engagement and involvement. And it doesn't always look the same. It doesn't always look like you're coming to an event. It doesn't always look like you're coming to a meeting. But what it does is it connects you to this whole group of parents, and people contribute in different ways. And we know folks have different work schedules, they have different things on their plates, but that's the beauty of being connected, is that you're working kind of towards the same vision.
Absolutely.
Superintendent Carranza makes a great point. The whole network that's available to PTA members in terms of support from other parents is really quite valuable. And back to school also provides an opportunity for parents to get to know their child's teacher and principal so that later in the year, if issues do come up, the parent has already spoken to the teacher or given the teacher a heads up about particular challenges for their child. And so back to school is a non-threatening environment for parents to make that connection with teachers. So later on, when that communication is really important, when teachers and parents really need to focus attention on the student, that's possible.
No, I think that's a great point. Getting to know your teacher is so important, especially because kids have a new teacher, it seems like, every year. First grade's a new teacher, second grade's a new teacher, and every teacher works differently. And so it is really important for parents to get to know who their child's teacher is going to be for this year. And you're right, you know, let the teachers know maybe a little bit more about their child so that the teacher's prepared for any maybe difficulties or challenges that one of their students might have. So what tips do you guys have for parents and families to actually connect with principals and teachers? I mean, we said talk to them, but what are some tips that you actually have to get the parents to talk to them?
I'll take the first stab at this question. I think what's really critically important is that we're in a people business. So we work with people. So it, just a simple introduction of, you know, the back to school night, some folks will say, well, we're not going to talk about grades. We're not going to talk about grading policies. We're not going to talk about nuts and bolts. What's really important is establishing that relationship so that the teacher knows the parent knows the teacher, and obviously the child knows the parent and the teacher. Also, I think what's really clear is that teachers and principals need to have an understanding of any particular concerns that a parent may have, any history that a student may have. You know, a student may be very, very shy and absolutely doesn't like to speak in public. Well, the teacher will take that information knowing that and not put a student in a position where they're embarrassed.
Right.
But work on developing that skill set. That's the kind of information that I think is really, really important when parents and teachers make a connection in that way. And I think the third thing that I would say that is so critically important is having a clear understanding on the part of parents what the educational outcomes are for their students that year. And it's a very simple question, but not a simplistic answer. The question really is, when my child enters this grade, what will my child have learned by the time they finish this grade? And how will that set them up for the next grade? And this is so important, especially now with the Common Core standards that we're transitioning to and the deeper levels of learning. That's a rich conversation that parents and teachers and actually our entire community should really, really be engaging in. So it's really important now more than ever.
Great tip, Superintendent Carranza. So how can parents help reinforce and support learning at home? Because I know that's an important part too.
Well, every opportunity away from school really presents a learning opportunity. So something as simple as going grocery shopping for dinner is an opportunity for parents to reinforce math concepts. Let's plan a meal. Let's make the meal. Let's follow a recipe. Well, there you have foresight in planning. You have nutrition. You have fractions, perhaps, when you're making the recipe. And all of this is reinforced at home during dinner time. Plus, eating a meal together is a really great opportunity for families to share what's happened throughout the day, minimize electronic devices, just really focus on one another and what's happened throughout the day. So something as simple as going to the grocery store can actually be a learning experience to reinforce what happened at school.
That's actually really interesting. I would have never put that together. But you're right, it makes complete sense.
As well, just as you're suggesting, a home environment that encourages learning, that's really the biggest factor in a child's success. And there are all sorts of different ways and easy ways to be able to support your child. Take time, 15, 20 minutes every day, and read with your child. That gives you some special time, one-on-one time with your child, makes them feel special, reinforces what they're learning at school. You know, try to have books around your house, have magazines, newspapers. It honestly doesn't matter what a child reads, it's the act of reading that's so important to be able to reinforce that at home. Having art supplies around, simple art supplies, get some paper out, grab some crayons, maybe some markers or paint, and sit down with your child and have some fun, do some finger painting with younger children and to just enjoy the moment with them.
Absolutely.
I think incorporating physical activity into the day is really important as well for children. Building in unstructured time for our students is so important, particularly in the middle and high school level when already students are feeling very much pressure to be college prepared, work very hard. And that's not to minimize the importance of that. However, students also need some unstructured time. And so any opportunity to walk with parents, to walk as a family, to go to the park together, those are like little mini field trips throughout the week that also can reinforce the learning that's happened at school.
These are great tips. I would only add this, that I really appreciate the comment about unstructured time. It's incredibly important that students have physical activity, but also good nutrition. And this is a booming epidemic in terms of unhealthy kids. There is an absolute correlation between a healthy mind and a healthy body. So it's critically important that parents help enforce. As school districts, we're working really hard to increase the level of nutritional value of all of our school meals. So whatever parents can do to help support that at home is critically important. And I also hear from parents often, especially as students move into the higher grades, they'll say, well, I don't remember what algebra is, and I don't remember geometry.
Right.
It's not necessarily important for you to be an expert in that content area. There's an old adage that says, what gets monitored gets done. So if you provide a space where students can do their homework and you ask to see the homework, show me your homework. Not Did you have homework? Show me your homework. Show me when it's completed. Great. You don't have to know about the homework, but the very act of students knowing that mom and dad or mom or aunt, somebody's going to ask them about it, will be that extra incentive to make sure it gets done. And let me tell you, if it gets done, we have great teachers that'll make sure they're doing it right.
So that's right.
All of those things, I think, are just work in concert to help support learning.
One way parents can also really support their children is make sure they get a good night's sleep. And we know that particularly for younger children, in order for them to be able to cope during the school day, they really need to be well rested. And parents can ensure that children get a full night's sleep and are ready to go the next day.
You know, that is so important, you know, especially as I had mentioned earlier, you know, with summer, with the kids getting to stay up a little bit later, that really is important, making sure that the kids have their set bedtime at 8 o'clock or 9 o'clock to ensure that they're getting their full 8 hours of sleep. Some need a little bit more. Some need 9 hours of sleep. But it really is important, because when a student is tired, because I do remember this being in school, when I was tired, I was not focused. I was not paying attention. And did I remember what I learned? No, I sure didn't. And so you're right. That is actually really important, is getting a good night's sleep, as well as, you know, reinforce the healthy nutrition that the schools are doing, because I know that is a big thing right now that we're working on. And it's important for moms and dads or aunties or uncles, grandmas, whoever you're with, to reinforce that as well. Serve the healthy snacks, the apples, the fruits, the vegetables, whatever it might be, as opposed to the potato chips. Go with the crackers. But it really is interesting to think, when you talk about reinforcing what the kids are learning in school, it's not just what they're learning in the classroom, you know, the math, the English, the social studies, but it's the health, the nutrition, it's sleep. You know, it really translates more to just what they're learning in their chair in the classroom. So great tips. Now, I know that there are some big changes happening in education. Can you tell us a little bit about the new state standards that are happening?
Sure. Well, parents are going to hear more and more about the Common Core state standards. And what this is actually something to be very excited about. You know, we know for a fact that for students to be successful, either in a career or in college, and then a career after college, there are certain skill sets that people have to have. You have to be able to communicate effectively. You have to be able to work in a team. You have to be a lifelong learner. What does that mean? That means that you have to be able to seek out information. You need to be able to think. If you think about the fact that you have more ability to find information at your fingertips on your mobile phone than we had in libraries, then it's not so important that you can find information, but that you can discern what's credible information and not credible information.
Right.
That takes a lot of skill. When we talk about 21st century learning skill sets, that's what we're talking about. The Common Core state standards are absolutely geared towards developing those skill sets. So now it's not so much knowing, although it's important to know that 2 + 2 = 4, what's even more important is to know that what 2 + the plus means with 2. Because when you can add 2 + 2, then you can add 1 million plus 1.57 million. It's the function that becomes important.
Right.
That's what we mean when we talk about deeper learning, and it all builds upon each other. So it's an exciting time in American education. I think it's going to prepare our students to be very competitive globally, as well as here in the United States. And what I absolutely love about this is that it's not sacrificing the arts. It's not sacrificing communication. I think we have an opportunity to re-amplify the full spectrum of the curriculum for our students, which is an exciting time for us in education.
PTA is very excited about the Common Core state standards. These standards really do set high expectations for all children. They ensure that children are working toward college and career readiness. The standards are research and evidence-based, and they really build on the foundation throughout the states, and so there is some continuity across states. Superintendent Carranza mentioned earlier how each standard is, or each grade is, a stepping stone to the next, and this is a really important development in our curriculum.
Maggie, do you have anything to add?
Well, the Common Core standards are really going to set the bar higher for our students, and that's a good thing because they do have high expectations for all students. That means that they're going to be better in terms of being college ready, and they are going to be able to compete much more strongly with the 21st century economy in a global world. And I think that's why everyone's kind of excited these are coming on board. Common Core standards are also going to make it easier for groups like military families, because what it means is that there's going to be similarities of what your child is learning in one school school, and if you get transferred to another county, you're going to be having the same kind of standards that are imposed in that county for education. And that's going to make it a lot easier for groups like military families.
That's a great, great point there. So let's talk about how the schools are actually funded. Now, I heard there are big changes in that area as well. Is that true?
Yes. Yes, it is true. So, again, you know, the California PTA was extremely, extremely involved in the funding of our schools and the Proposition 30 and the propositions around school funding as well. This is a prime example of where parents' voices really get heard. And what I like to share with communities as I go around talking to communities is, with the passage of Prop 30, folks think that there's this huge influx of new resources to schools. That's not quite the case yet. But what is fundamentally different this year than in past years is that Prop 30 now has identified what the basement is. So every year when we were opening school, we were opening cutting. So the basement was never sure. We were always cutting and it was going lower and lower. While we haven't rebuilt the funding to where we should be, it at least has established a basement so that we can at least build some semblance of stability this year as the funding formula starts kicking in. With the addition of the local control funding formula that the governor has passed and the legislature has passed, the local control funding formula is allowing school districts to actually use their resources to target in an equitable way students and student groups that need the support to actually meet the rigorous demands of the Common Core and the 21st century learning standards. So there's a real sense of optimism. I'll tell you, our students in San Francisco this week have been in session already for the week. The teachers came back the week before. And as I've gone to school sites and met with teachers and administrators and parent groups, there's a real sense of optimism that we did this together. So now what's our next challenge?
Yeah.
And the next challenge really is to really implement in a very, very strategic and good way the tools that we've been given through all of our collective efforts to show that we can make a difference.
That's great.
One of the ways parents can really now be involved under this new local control funding formula is that school districts must get input from local communities, from parents, from educators on how the funds will be used at the school district to impact the education
really?
Of students.
Wow.
So they school districts have an obligation to tie their budgets to the improvement goals that they've developed around these local accountability plans. And this is where parents can really ensure that their voice is heard, that their children's needs are being met. It's an opportunity to really impact how school districts are investing the funds for our students and to ensure that students' needs are truly being met.
I think that's great. I know parents are probably always asking, you know, where's my money going? Where do my tax dollars go? Where's my money going? Why is it being spent this way? Why is it being spent that way? So I think it's really great that the parents' voice are going to be heard now. That's great.
It's also an opportunity to continue to address the issue of adequacy, because we know, as the superintendent mentioned, that we aren't where we need to be. And so parents can continue to advocate for this adequacy, because it's adequacy that's going to allow our students to really excel in the Common Core state standards. It's adequacy that's going to allow our students to experience the arts, to be ensured there's a school nurse on campus, to make sure that the well-rounded education that they deserve is really present.
Absolutely. Well, we're just about out of time here, but I would love for each of you to send any messages out there to our parents and any messages that you want to get out there that we may not have talked about today.
What I'd like to say is that parents have an essential role in their child's education, and never minimize the amount of influence that you have on your child. Simply being engaged by joining PTA, supporting what your child does at school and at home, attending back to school nights, asking questions, all of those show your child that you really value education and that you're really invested in their achievement.
And I think Colleen's right. The idea of being able to signal to your child that you really value education, what they do all day at school is really important to your family. All of that helps the child succeed academically and socially. And so it's important for us as parents to make that a priority and let our children understand that we love what they do at school and we want them to succeed at school.
Great. And Superintendent Carranza.
Sure. I have a hard time following these very eloquent ladies because they've said exactly the way I feel. I would only add this, that for any parent that is wondering, well, I can't make a meeting, so I can't be involved, or I can't join the PTA because I can't do whatever it is. There is no formula for involvement. It's whatever you can do. And we realize folks work multiple jobs. We recognize that family configurations are very different. There is room for any iteration of a family that you can think of in parent involvement. Parent involvement is just very much being involved in knowing what your child is. And when we think about it, parents, this is the most valuable thing, if you will, we have, our children.
That's right.
And we would never think of opening the door at night and saying to our kids, just go out and we'll see you when you get back. I don't really want to know where you are. I really don't want to know what you're doing. I really don't want to know what you're learning.
Right.
That's just abhorrent to us. So using the same concept, it behooves us to be involved in our students' education. What are you learning? Who are you learning that with? What are your goals? What can I do to support you? That's all part of parent involvement. So there's room for everyone to be involved.
Well, I want to thank all three of you for taking the time to be here today and getting our parents ready to go back to school and getting our kids ready to go back to school and talking about parent involvement, because that really is going to play a huge role in your child's life. We do want to encourage all of our parents out there to get involved with their child's school's PTA, especially if you want your voice to be heard. That's the only way it's going to happen. So talk to your principals, talk to your teachers, and find out about the school PTA that's happening at your child's school. Or you can go on to the California State PTA's website as well, right?
That's correct. Our website is www.capta.org. And there you'll find the back to school tips that we talked about. You'll find guides for the Common Core State Standards and just a wealth of information to support you and your child on this journey.
Perfect. So again, get involved with your PTA. And thank you all once again for being here today. It was great chatting with all of you.
Thank you.
Let's chat right here on Radio Disney AM 1310.